Well, good morning. We've got a few minutes before we get started here, but this will be our last Sunday of the year. It's kind of an amazing thing, so we'll get started here shortly.
So weird.
I wish it could be Christmas all year long.
I love Christmas music.
I do too.
Of course, it wouldn't matter what music it was. I'd drive people crazy whistling and singing anyway.
That sound is picking up pretty amazing.
And that's just that one on. Yep.
Depends on which clock you are going by.
Yeah, that one is on the money.
Yep.
That one matches this one, so starts a few seconds later than usual. That's okay. What's that?
If it's quiet for too long, I'll fall asleep.
I'll wake you up.
Okay. For some reason, I woke up this morning at 4 o'clock knowing I had to go wash clothes.
Laundry.
And that's time.
Good morning from Happy Camp. Glad that you could be with us. Before we get going, let's pray, give our day to the Lord, and we'll get started. So, Father, thank you so much for a very beautiful day. Father, as we draw near to the end of 2020, Lord, we are so grateful that you have been with us, that you have never left us. You never will leave us. You never will forsake us. And though we've been through some trials and tribulations with sorts of issues this year. Father, we know that we have the hope of heaven. We know that this is not our home. But Father, it has got to be better than this. And Lord, I am so grateful that we have a hope that lies in you and with you. Because without that hope, Father, we would be a miserable people. But because of the hope that we have in you, Father, we can sing for joy. We can be excited about life. We can move through the disappointments and the trials and the tribulations, knowing, Father, that you are working it in our lives. You are doing things to change us. And Father, we can trust you. So Father, help us to just give you this next year, to allow you to work your promises in us. We thank you, we praise you, we give you this time. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Okay, well, that said, let's go over some prayer requests. First of all, thank you, Vicki Simmons, for telling us that the sound was poor last week. We've made some adjustments this week and found some of the problem, the issue that we were having, and hopefully it is better this week, and we'll continue as we got a little different adapter there for the camera. So, but our prayer requests. Operation Christmas Child, continue to pray for that program. I am excited to see where our boxes ended up. But keep praying for the kids and their families. Pray for their salvation, but also the salvation of our own families and our own friends as we continue just to trust the Lord in each one of those situations. Because with God, how many things are possible?
All things.
All things are possible. So, if he can reach us, he can reach our families. So keep praying for the salvation, especially as it seems like the end is drawing near. The Lord is coming back soon. So keep praying for your families, your friends, your communities. Pray for our nation. The Lord asks us to pray for our leadership. Pray for our leadership. This has been a very unusual year. With the elections, if you want to call them that. It has been kind of crazy to see some of the stuff that we have been seeing, and yet we know that the end has to involve some of these things. So keep praying for our leadership, whoever that may be, whether you like them or you don't. The Lord still asks us to pray. Pray for Israel. They've been going through some bumpy times as well, and that, and then other prayer requests. Peggy Shroy, keep praying for cancer for her. Alba needs prayer. Jimmy, that his surgery will have taken place. Perhaps Vicki can. Do we have an update for him?
We do have an update. Okay. Jimmy is home from a grueling back operation on the 23rd. He is in pain, but happy to be home. Please keep praying. Thank you.
Oh, good. Okay, so he did get his surgery, so now he just needs to recover.
Yes.
And whatnot from that back surgery. So keep praying that recovery will go smoothly and well, and that he will be healed completely. So Alice's husband, Jim, and his cancer. Regina's daughter's pregnancy went well. The family looks happy and healthy, and it's great to see families taking their pictures of Christmas. I love this. I really do not much care for being in pictures, but I certainly love looking at them later and seeing all the joy on people's faces. So, also keep praying for Frank. And his cancer, as well as the expenses involved there. Pray that the Lord would continue to keep meeting those needs. Debbie Jacobson with her shoulder replacement and therapy there. Dan Bushy is now home after being gone for 3 months, so praise the Lord for that. He's still going to need a considerable amount of help, so pray for Judy and some of the issues that she's going to have to deal with in that regard. Praise the Lord that he's back home and can feel comfortable and at rest. I love what she said, that she gave him a little manger scene and he would set it up there at his bedside and love to just spread the word and tell people about Jesus, which is awesome. So, you know, that's always been a passion for Dan. So, keep praying for him. Zaya, there's a couple folks there that just need some direction, some wisdom, as well as health-related issues. I have probably forgotten some. One I know that's not on this list is Zach Ablett, who was the young man who had his C5 and 6 crush in a surfing / diving accident. And anyhow, just keep praying for him. He is now in Colorado at Craig Hospital, and they are doing some pretty amazing therapy with him. And he went from pretty much having nothing from about shoulders down to now regaining just about everything, with the exception of some fingers from his waist up, which is absolutely wonderful and amazing after a couple of surgeries. Pray, though, that the Lord would completely restore him. Mm-hmm. He is just an amazing young man and belongs to an amazing family. And they love the Lord deeply. And they pastor a fellowship over in Brookings. So pray for that fellowship as they continue to miss the family and that kind of stuff. So let's give these prayers. And if you have other requests, please post them, or you can message me, and we'd be happy to continue to pray with you and for you. So, Father, we thank you so much that you are concerned with each and every one of us. Father, you left heaven to come and die for our sins, our greatest need. But, Father, you also say that we have not because we ask not. So, Father, I pray that each one of these requests, that, Father, you would just minister, that you would touch, that you would heal, that you would restore, that you would bring wisdom and direction, that you would be a guide for each and every one. Father, thank you that you hear our prayers, but you don't just hear them, Father, you react, you move, you work. And Father, I'm so grateful to know that we can come right before your presence, that we don't have anything that is blocking us, anything that is in our way to reach you, but we can come boldly before your throne. Father, thank you for that. And Lord, we just want to lay these at your feet and pray that you would do what is absolutely best and to do those things which would bring you glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
All right. Well, Bible studies. We're going to start a midweek study, the Rev study, here at the beginning of the year. And so we will be going into Revelation, and we'll just be kind of working our way through that. I will say that this could be interrupted by an ambulance call, as I'm still on duty during those times. So just be forewarned that that could happen, but we'll probably be doing that from my home, and we'll just have a good time going through the book of Revelation. You know, the book of Revelation says that whoever reads it is blessed, and so we could probably all stand to have a little bit of blessing after going through 2020, and we don't know what 2021 will hold, so just go through Revelation and we'll at least receive a blessing from being in the Word. So we'll do the Rev study on Wednesday nights, probably around 6 or 7. I'll let you know as that goes, probably closer to 7. The men's prayer breakfast, I know that they had planned on possibly starting that back up at the beginning of the year, and that would be at the Bible Church at 7 in the morning on Fridays. However, this Friday is New Year's Day, so it won't be happening then, but perhaps we can get an update from Bob and from Bill, and we can get a direction on those sorts of things. Other things, next year, next Sunday, we are going to start back to our regular full services, in-person services. After doing even more research about the numbers that we thought were just exploding during Thanksgiving and Christmas, it turns out that even though COVID numbers were going up, other disease processes that people die from, COPD, asthma, diabetes, heart disease, those kinds of things went way down, which is interesting because when you look at the percentage of those things that went down versus the percentage of COVID going up, the numbers are the same or nearly the same. So the reality is there's no more people dying from anything different. So the same amount of people nearly that would be dying from heart disease and COPD and those things that life has done to folks is equal to the number of those that supposedly are dying from COVID. So we're going to go back to in-person services. I will say this, when you come, if you are sick, turn around, go home, go rest. get some good breath. This is that time of year where you can get all kinds of things, flus and colds and things like that. If you're sick, join us online. We'll continue to do that. If you are healthy, you are welcome to come join us here starting next year on Sundays at 10:30. And we will, if you wish to wear a mask, you can do so. If you don't want to wear one, I'm not going to make you. So we are just at that point now where we need to get back to fellowshipping. I am missing that greatly. It really, truly is essential. In fact, in Acts 2:42, it says that the apostles continue steadfastly in the doctrine, in the breaking of bread, in prayer, and in fellowship. Those are necessary for a healthy church. And though we've taken a break over the holidays just to be sure that no one would be affected in a negative way by things going on here at church, we are going to continue now into the new year with regular services. So join us next Sunday as we start the new year off in person. And I am looking forward to that. The crime study, Sunday school will be happening as well, so we'll continue on with those ministries, and perhaps we'll figure out whether or not David's going to continue his online hosting of the crime study. We'll see. But he had a very good one last week and the week before that, so praise the Lord. Giving. Again, thank you for your generous giving. I am amazed at how gracious the Lord has been to us to allow us to continue to do this here at the community center, here in our community, but also because of the devastation that has taken place here in Happy Camp from the fire, the Slater fire. Boy, the Lord has just continued to bless and meet the needs of folks in our community. And so thank you for your giving. Again, it's tax deductible. We're at the end of the year, so go ahead and make out your last check, and you can send that to us at the P.O. box, or you can do that through the Tithely app. If you happen to be here, you can give in the wood box. So that said, let's continue to move forward. Amazing facts that will blow your mind. How do you know that it is cold in Florida when the iguanas fall out of the trees? This is interesting. I saw this article, this news article here the other day, and they were saying, hey, watch out for falling iguanas. You see, when Florida gets below 40 degrees, as they are expecting, I think, this week, or perhaps this past weekend, they warn people to watch out because those warm-blooded lizards just drop out of the sky because it's just too doggone cold. So how do you know it's cold in Florida? When the iguanas are falling out of the trees.
That's pretty funny.
That is funny.
Okay, birthdays? No birthdays this week. However, I think today is Karen Dancy's birthday, so happy birthday. I know she's no longer in our part of the country. I think she's still in California, though.
Yeah.
So happy birthday, Karen, if you happen to tune in. And with that said, we are going to continue our study, and we are going to do our worship at the end of the teaching, like we did last week.
Sweet.
So,
all right, we can sit and listen.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
So that said, why don't you turn in your Bibles to Luke chapter 1? If you don't have a Bible, perhaps you could use your device, or you got a computer you can log into and that sort of stuff. So, Luke chapter 1, and this one we're going to title A Happy New Year. New. Well, we love new things. We tend to shop during Christmas for all sorts of new things. Perhaps you're saying, man, I would like a new car, a new job, a new hairdo, a new home. Maybe perhaps you want a new kid, or another kid, whatever the case may be. But new is interesting. We are always desiring to get away from the old. Why? What's the problem with old? It tends to be falling apart, huh? And the older I get, the more I realize that is true. We are falling apart. So, is new better than old? Sometimes. Some would say, although I don't like the stuff, wine gets better with age. I don't know about that. It's still just rotting grapes and tastes nasty. but I have a weird tongue, right?
You don't have new
Is new beneficial? New can be beneficial. Not always, but sometimes. If you've got that clunker car that you're driving around, like Heather was, and then you go get a new car, there's a skip in your step and a smile on your face because things are working right. things like that. We could stand probably for a new year. After 2020, I've heard a lot of folks say, hey, look, let's just be done with this year early, and no, it doesn't work that way, but we would like to have a new year. We want a do-over, so to speak, and continue on because of COVID and all of the other sorts of things that have gone on. So, but new is not always better because we don't know exactly what 21 will hold. So, but we can certainly hope, we can certainly pray, and we can enjoy what is placed before us. At the end of the year, we are often told to come up with a new year's what?
Resolution,
right? Oh, I'm going to lose weight again for the 25th time. Pardon me. Things like that. The problem with new is that sometimes it comes with payments. You know, a new car comes with a new car payment. A new house, same thing. That hairdo isn't free. You still gotta do it. Even if you say, well, it's only a few bucks out of the bottle, but I've seen some pretty amazing hairdos that came out of the bottle. That new job, it may come with perhaps a nicer paycheck, but maybe not nicer coworkers or a nicer boss or whatnot. Just because it's new doesn't mean that it's good. But here's the thing, as we get into Luke chapter 1, one thing that I appreciate about that is that we do have good news that has been given. And Luke starts out the good news. And I think that we will go back, in a sense, to the beginning here of Luke and just remember the good news. Verse 1, many people have set out to write accounts about the events that have been fulfilled among us. They use the eyewitness reports circulating among us from the early disciples. Having carefully investigated everything from the beginning, I also have decided to write an accurate account for you, most honorable Theophilus, so you can be certain of the truth of everything you were taught. Now, who is Luke? Luke is a doctor. In that day, even as we talked about at the beginning of Acts, and we'll go back to Acts starting next week, and pick up where we left off there in Acts. But Luke was writing this to his boss. Doctors, you didn't just go visit, you actually employed them if you could afford to. And so Luke, more than likely, was working for Theophilus as well as teaching him about the good news that Jesus is the Savior of the world. Luke, being a doctor, having knowledge, having some schooling, because of his history and his background, he would have been very much into digging down deep to find problems or solutions. He would have been very thorough. Otherwise, you're just not really much of a doctor. Luke says here that he carefully investigated everything so that they would have an accurate account. And I like that. Luke has done the job. He said, I have done this, Theophilus, and of course for us, so that you can be certain of the truth of everything that you were taught. And I like that. Luke does a very detailed job. It's a very large book for the Gospels, and it is very detailed, which is wonderful. Verse 5, when Herod was king of Judea, there was a Jewish priest named Zechariah, and he was a member of the priestly order of Abijah. And his wife Elizabeth was also from the priestly line of Aaron. Zechariah and Elizabeth were righteous in God's eyes, careful to obey all of the Lord's commandments and regulations. They had no children because Elizabeth was unable to conceive, and they were both very old. So now, I know that a couple of weeks ago, David Colbert taught on this particular chapter, and he did a good job. So I would tell you to tune in to some of those teachings that he's done. They are on the church website at happycampfellowship.org. And we're going to piggyback off of that direction, in a sense, in this same chapter, and bring in the new year in a good way. So, what is happening here? Zechariah is a minister to the people. When you were a priest in that time frame, you represented God to the people and the people to the Father. You were the representative. Not everybody could just go into the temple. You couldn't just show up in church in the Holy of Holies. You had to go through quite a process, quite a step-by-step direction. If you did it wrong and you had sin in your heart that was not forgiven, you ended up dead, and they had to pull you out from a rope. Zechariah, here we are told from the Lord, he was very careful, as was Elizabeth, to do what? Obey all of the Lord's commandments. So he was a very righteous guy. He did what is right, as did Elizabeth. And yet, in spite of that, they had no kids because Elizabeth could not conceive. That is tough. That is a tough thing for some folks that cannot have children, that really desire in their heart of hearts to have that. Well, one day, Zechariah was serving God in the temple, for his order was on duty that week. They shared the duties. They would go and take turns week by week as to who would perform the duties for the people to the Lord and, again, give the message that your sins are forgiven back from the Lord to the people. Verse 9, as was the custom of the priest, he was chosen by lot to enter the sanctuary of the Lord and burn incense. And while the incense was being burned, a great crowd stood outside praying. Yes, they stood outside praying, possibly confessing their sin, saying, Lord, please forgive us. We've missed the mark. We've failed. We've faltered. And Lord, please, the sacrifices that have been made, please accept those for our sin. That was the Old Testament or the Old Covenant. That is what we see. We don't actually get into the New Covenant or the New Testament until when? Until Jesus dies on the cross. Mm-hmm. However, we know that Jesus had the plan before the foundations of the world. He said, no, I am going to be willing to come to earth and die, to suffer, and go through the same sort of things that we go through. But he did it without failure, without sin, without faltering. Here, the people were waiting outside to hear those words, your sins are forgiven. So Zechariah is inside the temple. He is burning incense, praising God, thanking God, worshiping God on behalf of the people before entering in to the Holy of Holies and then sprinkling there the blood from those sacrifices. Well, a great crowd stood outside and praying as he was doing his duty inside. Verse 11, while Zechariah was in the sanctuary, an angel of the Lord appeared to him standing to the right of the incense altar. Zechariah was shaken and overwhelmed with fear when he saw him. But the angel said, do not be afraid, Zechariah. God has heard your prayer. Your wife Elizabeth will give you a son, and you are to name him John. You will have great joy and gladness, and many will rejoice at his birth. Continue on here in just a minute. So, Zach would have been praying for the people. This angel appears on the scene, and, you know, he would have been praying, hey, Lord, you are wonderful, you are merciful, you are kind, you are gracious. I am now bringing the people's sin before you. Please forgive. He was waiting for the angel to, or waiting for the Lord to say, yes, their sins are forgiven, the sacrifice had taken, that kind of thing. When this angel shows up, which we'll find out here in a moment, is Gabriel. And he says, hey, the Lord has heard your prayer. Now, that would have been interesting. It was his turn to go in and perform the duties for the people. Perhaps he had done this in the past, but this time the angel shows up and he's thinking, wow, this is a change. This is not what I expected. In fact, the angel even says, don't be afraid. It startled him, apparently. But boy, what good news to hear that God has answered your prayer. Keep praying. The Lord does answer prayer. He has done amazing things in 2020. We have seen prayers answered. Things that that we would normally expect to be absolutely devastating have become an absolute miracle and blessing and testimony of God's goodness. So continue to pray. Continue to offer up your requests so that we can continue to be witnesses of the Lord, of his goodness, his grace, his mercy, and his kindness. So here, he's praying. He's thinking, great, the Lord has answered my prayer. The sins of the people are forgiven. However, that is not the prayer that he was speaking of, Gabriel. He said, your wife Elizabeth will give you a son. Perhaps he had stopped praying for that prayer some time ago, as they were, as the scripture says, very old. And it says here in verse 14, you will have great joy and gladness, and many will rejoice at his birth, for he will be great in the eyes of the Lord. He must never touch wine or other alcoholic drinks. Why? Well, pretty much every mention in the Bible about alcohol is negative, with the exception of the wedding, that Jesus turned water into wine. The idea behind wine is to bring joy, but we abuse a lot of those things. And so the Lord says, I want this young man to be focused. I think it's great for pastors, leaders, elders, to follow what the scripture says and stay away from those things that distract you from being focused on Jesus, the author and the perfecter of our faith. Those things tend to lead us into areas that are bad. Now, I'm not saying you don't drink at all. You can do that if you wish. But some people, the Lord has said, no, you know, you're not going to do that. And so here, this young man, who we know to be John Baptist, will be different. He will be set apart. He will set an example to the people. And so here, it also says that he will be filled with the Holy Spirit even before his birth. And he will turn many Israelites to the Lord their God. He will be a man with the spirit and the power of Elijah. He will prepare the people for the coming of the Lord. And he will turn the hearts of the father to their children. And he will cause those who are rebellious to accept the wisdom of the godly. Verse 18, Zechariah said to the angel, how can I be sure this will happen? I am an old man now, and my wife is also well along in years. Now, this guy's kind of smart here. Even though his wife isn't listening, he is very careful to say, I am old, however, my wife is well along in years. He did not call her old, which is good. Smart guy. But here he does ask a question that when we look at the wording is literally filled with doubt. Because we know that with God, how many things are possible? All things, as we will be told here in the scripture. All things are possible with God unless we what? Unless we doubt. That really takes away from God's ability to do things. Because if you're not going to believe him, then even if he did something, you still aren't going to what? Believe him. So it makes it very difficult for him to do any kind of work when you and I doubt him, doubt his word, doubt the things that he says. Here, Gabriel says, Zechariah says to Gabriel, how can I be sure this will happen? There's a lot of doubt in that conversation. Then the angel said, and I know that we tend to want to read this with maybe an angry retort, but no, that's not how he said it. He said, listen, I am Gabriel. I stand in the very presence of God. It is he who sent me to bring you this good news. Good news. You are going to have a baby, even in your old age. Yeah, but how can I be sure? I want some proof. I'm standing before you right now. I stand in the very presence of God, and I'm telling you this is what God has said. I'm disappointed that you don't believe me. You were shocked that I even showed up today. you know, and yet you're not believing that God is going to do what seems to you to be impossible. Boy, how many times do we doubt our own prayers? We pray, and then we don't pray really believing. Well, here, Gabriel says, look, I stand in the very presence of God, and I am here to bring you good news. But since you don't believe, since you won't trust the word of God, then there's going to be some difficulties. In fact, what I will be, instead of you being able to go outside and rejoice with your voice, and I'm going to take it away. The Lord is going to take it away. But now, since you didn't believe what I said, you will be silent and unable to speak until the child is born. For my words will certainly be fulfilled at the proper time. God's promises, the scripture tells us, are yes and what? Amen. Or so be it. It will be done. God doesn't take away his promise simply because Zach didn't want to believe. He doesn't take back the promise. He will fulfill the promise regardless. However, your ability to enjoy that will be diminished. You won't be able to go out and give God glory in the same way you could had you done it with full faith and full belief and full trust in God. You need to do it. Why? Because at the proper time, everything that God does has a proper time. When you pray and you say, yeah, but I don't see God working, I don't see him moving, I don't see him answering my prayer, that's because you're trying to see the prayer fulfilled in your time frame and not God's. If it's done in your time frame, that wouldn't be proper, and something would be negatively affected. Here God said, I want this to be perfect. I want this to be the perfect timing. And so I am going to do this and fulfill this at the proper, at the perfect time. Verse 21, meanwhile, the people were waiting for Zechariah to come out of the sanctuary, wondering why he was taking so long. They had hoped that he didn't croak. See, in that day and age, when they would go into the Holy of Holies, they would wear bells and pomegranates around the bottom of their robe. That way, when they were praying and moving around, you could hear the bells ringing. But if the bells stopped for a certain length of time, well, then I guess we'll have to drag out the priest because he did not have a clean and pure heart, and he died in the presence of the Lord. And, we'll have to just drag him out. So they would tie a rope to their leg. Well, here, the people were wondering, Zechariah still alive in there? Well, verse 22, when he finally did come out, he couldn't speak to them. And then they realized from his gestures and his silence that he must have seen a vision in the sanctuary. They realized that something unique had happened, but he could not say a word. God fulfills his promises at the proper time. Look, if you're not going to sing praises and glories, if you're going to doubt me, it's going to be very difficult for you to speak to somebody and share the good news, isn't it? The same is true for you and I. It's hard for you and I to share the good news that we are forgiven if we don't really believe that God is going to do the things that he says he's going to do in our word. We will be, in a sense, spiritually silent. Not a good thing to do. Verse 23, when Zechariah's week of service in the temple was over, he returned home. Soon afterward, his wife Elizabeth became pregnant and went into seclusion for 5 months. Verse 25, how kind the Lord is, she exclaimed. I like this. A little bit different version than Zach's. I'm sure that when Zechariah came home, he was unable to speak to his wife, and yet he probably found a way to communicate to her that the Lord was going to have a miracle happen in their lives and that they were going to have a baby. She believed. She got pregnant, and she says, boy, the Lord is so kind. And isn't the Lord kind? He is so good to us. We made it through 2020. And for those of us that didn't, if they knew the Lord, like my mom, she is in heaven, standing in the very presence of the Lord. And that is an amazing thing. How kind the Lord is, she exclaimed. He has taken away my disgrace of having no children. You see, it would have been a disgrace during that time because many people thought that the reason that bad things happen is because you sinned and God is punishing you. You may feel that way about your own situation. God must be punishing me because nothing good seems to be happening to me in 2020. That's not the case. Life happens. This world is full of sin. But we have to believe that God is going to do the miraculous at the proper time. He's going to answer your prayers at the proper time. So don't give up. In verse 26, we continue on in this story. Now, in the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a village in Galilee, to the virgin named Mary. And she was engaged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of King David. Gabriel appeared to her and said, "Greetings, favored woman." Wow. What a blessing that would be when an angel who is standing in the presence of the Lord comes and says, "Wow, you are a blessed woman. You are a happy woman. You are above and beyond what every other woman has been. You are an amazing thing." Especially being that in that day and age, or at the age that Mary would have been, around 12 or 13 years old, that says a lot about Mary. And God says, "You are favored. You are a favored woman. You are a blessed woman. The Lord is with you." That is also a blessing to hear, that God is with us. And he is with you and I as well. In fact, he tells us he never leaves us or what? Forsakes us. So he is with us. Verse 29, confused and disturbed, Mary tried to think about what the angel could mean. Verse 30, "Don't be afraid, Mary," the angel told her, "for you have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son. And you will name him Jesus. He will be very great and will be called the Son of the Most High." Understanding now that when you are called the Son of God or the Son of the Most High, in that day and age, they would have understood that to mean he will be called God, God himself. We know that Isaiah tells us that he would be called Emmanuel, God with us. So she understands now that she will be having a son. The Lord will give him the throne of his ancestor David, and that this baby would not only be a king, but would also be God incarnate. Verse 33, "And he will reign over Israel forever. His kingdom will never end. It'll go on forever and ever and ever." This has got to be an amazing thing. In fact, David's teaching last week was "Mary, Did You Know?" And he talks about the song, and it's beautiful. You should listen to that teaching. It's a very good teaching, short, but just it brings joy to your heart. And the same thing that would be happening here to Mary. Boy, what joy to know that you are going to be birthing the Savior, the God incarnate, who's going to be king, and his kingdom will last forever and ever. Just amazing thing. And then she asks the angel in verse 34, "But how can this happen? I am a virgin." Now we have to understand that Zechariah was not in the same position that Mary was in. He was married in that day and age. When you got married, there were three things that had to happen. First, the fathers had to agree that the son and the daughter were going to be joined in matrimony. So once the fathers agreed, that was step one. You didn't have a say-so. Step two, you actually stood before the Lord and the priest, and you would make your promise, your I do's, if you will. Do you promise? Do you promise? Yes. But then, because you have no place to stay and no home for your new wife, you would go home with your dad, and as the bridegroom, you would go and you would build a home on that property for your new wife. But she went home to stay with her folks until the father said, now's the time, go get your bride. And then you would come together, there would be a huge party, but there would also be a place to take your wife home to. And so there was a three-step process. Where is Mary in this process? Because she was engaged, the fathers had agreed, and Joseph and Mary had already made their vows to one another. However, they were not intimate because she would have gone home and he would have gone back to build a home for his bride and wait for the father to say, go get your bride. And that's the way things worked in their culture and in their day. So Mary asks a legitimate question. I can't have a baby because I haven't been intimate with a man. Zechariah asks a question. He doesn't say, I'm a virgin. He says, I know I'm married, but we can't have kids. Do you not know this? You know? He asks a very doubting question. Mary asks a very practical question. And so you can see that the very skeptical question from Zechariah's perspective is a lot different than the very practical question that Mary asks. How is this possible? How is this even physically possible? Because I have not known a man. I am a virgin. Very easy question to see. It's not that she's doubting. She's wanting to know practically how does this work, because we haven't come to step three. Well, verse 35, the angel replied, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Now, I know many have tried to tweak this verse into something very weird and very strange. They've tried to humanize God. But God, how did God create this world? It says, in the beginning, he spoke and things appeared. Here, it says that the Holy Spirit will come upon you. This speaks of the Shekinah glory, or the cloud that would come down into the temple when the sacrifice had been made for the people. And when God accepted that sacrifice, then the priest would come out of the temple and say, your sins are forgiven. God accept that. Well, his glory would come down in a cloud. That's the same idea here, that in a cloud, the Holy Spirit surrounded Mary, and whatever conversation took place there, the Lord created or placed Jesus into her womb. So the baby to be born will be holy, and he will be called the Son of God. Verse 36, what's more, your relative Elizabeth has become pregnant in her old age! Exclamation mark. The angel has no problem here calling Elizabeth old. No repercussions. People used to say that she was barren, but she has conceived a son and is now in her 6th month. Why? Because she prayed. And God, at the proper time, at the perfect time, is bringing a miraculous baby, John the Baptist, into the world, and also through Mary, bringing God Almighty down here to earth in a miraculous way. And the two will join together in a ministry like none other here on this planet, to let you and I know that not only are you forgiven, but you also can have the Holy Spirit in you, God with us, and that is an amazing thing. So he said, she is in her 6th month now, verse 37, for the word of God will never what? Fail. It will never fail. When God says something, when God has made you a promise, it is yes and amen. It will happen. Yeah, but what if I sin? What if I fail? What if I'm not doing good? It doesn't matter. God's promise will never fail. He will continue to do it. With God, all things are possible. And what does Mary say here? This is really the key point today. People said she was barren. God's word will never fail. And Mary responded with this: I am the Lord's servant. I am going to do whatever he tells me to do. May everything that you have said about me come true. And the angel then left her. Verse 39, a few days later, Mary hurried to the hill country of Judea, to the town where Zechariah lived. She entered the house and greeted Elizabeth. At the sound of Mary's greeting, Elizabeth's child, John the Baptist, leaped within her. I'm sure that felt pretty good. Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. Verse 42, Elizabeth gave a glad cry and exclaimed to Mary, God has blessed you above all women, and your child is blessed. Wow, what a greeting. Verse 43, as we wrap things up here, why am I so honored that the mother of my Lord should visit me? She didn't just believe that she was pregnant and believe what the angel had told Zechariah and believe her husband, but now, knowing what was happening in Mary and the greeting that she got and the word that she got from the Lord, knowing Mary, knowing what a wonderful gal she was and how holy she was, and how faithful she was to the Lord, that God had blessed her in a very unique way, and that she would be the virgin that was prophesied to have God Almighty born to her. When I heard your greeting, the baby in my womb jumped for joy. You know, this goes to prove that life, even in the belly, is truly life, and that we must honor that life. They can hear, they can feel, they can do all those things, so we need to celebrate life and not destroy it. The baby in my womb jumped for joy. You are blessed because you what? Believed. Elizabeth, an old gal, one of much wisdom, says, you are blessed. Why? Because you believed. You believed that the Lord would do what he said. And boy, that is such a key part of where we need to be for our new year. Do you want a new year? Do you want to move forward from the hurt, from the troubles, from the trials, the tribulations? Then you need to believe that the Lord is going to bless you, to bless me in 2021. That God will fulfill his promises to you and I. But you need to believe. If you doubt, then you're not going to have a voice that really speaks of how good God is. So what do we need to do? We need to believe. Do you want a happy new year? Then we need to go into the new year believing. What does blessing mean? You are blessed. Blessed in the scripture simply means happy. Do you want to be blessed? Do you want to be happy? Do you want to have a happy new year? Then we've got to believe. Amen? Let's sing some songs. And let's praise the Lord for his goodness. And we will bring in the new year, so to speak, praising the Lord. I want to see you, Jesus. Why? Because his words are true. Amen?
It's a good thing.
Open up.
Thank you. blessing. Now, this is a nice long song, but we'll get through it. I'm going to give a little bit of... But this is a great way to end the service by just praying a blessing, in a sense, upon you. And the Lord would bring you peace.
We need blessing. Blessings are good.
Thank you.
you so much that you have been such a blessing, that you are a blessing. You will continue to be a blessing. And I pray, Father, that we would trust you, that we would believe the promises that you have given to us, that we would not be spiritually closed up, that we would not be shut down by the enemy because of our doubt. Father, we know that your word tells us that when you went into your hometown, that you could do very few miracles because of doubt. Father, let that not be said of Happy Camp Christian Fellowship. Let that not be said of we as believers, we as a church. May, Father, it be said that we believe you, that we trust you, that we trust your timing, that you are perfect, and that you will unfold your perfection in our lives every day as we continue to walk in you and walk with you. Father, thank you that you have brought us through 2020, and that you will, at your proper time, bring us into 21 as well as home with you in heaven. Let us continue to speak boldly, to ask of you in prayer, and to be thankful for the things that you have done for us, because you are worthy. Father, we give you this day, we give you our new year, and we pray that it would be blessed in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, God bless you and keep you. May he make his face to shine upon you and give you peace in this new year. You are dismissed. Have a happy new year.